Over the past 50-odd years, we've sent robotic probes to explore our solar system, and they've sent back some amazing close-up images of the planets, asteroids, and even comets. But how did they take these images, and what sort of issues are there in taking photos in deep space and getting them back to Earth? In a previous video, we looked at how the first spy satellites used film to get the best quality available at the time, because electronically transferring images back to Earth wasn't of a high enough quality for the reconnaissance purposes. They were in orbit just a few hundred kilometers above the Earth, so they could drop the film back to Earth. But for the first space probes going to the Moon, Mars, Venus, and beyond, that wasn't an option. In 1959, Luna 3 became the first spacecraft to photograph the far side of the Moon, ironically using captured film that was temperature and radiation resistant and had been captured from US Genetrix spy balloons that had been shot down over the Soviet Union. The camera it used was a dual lens system with a 200mm wide angle that could image the whole Moon in one shot, and a 500mm for close-up shots of regions of the Moon. Though close-up wasn't really that close, as Luna 3 took images of the far side from around 65,000 kilometres. The camera was also fixed to the body of a craft, so Luna 3 was the first craft to use three-axis rotation to position itself to take the images. Once the images had been taken, the film was developed, fixed and dried on board, and then scanned electronically by passing it between a flying spot scanner and a light-sensitive sensor. A dot of light from the flying spot scanner traversed the film at a resolution of 1,000 lines per 35mm frame. This varying level of light was converted to an electronic signal and transmitted back to Earth. Here it was shown on a slow scan TV, and then that image was photographed, and that became what the rest of the world saw. The poor quality of the images is hardly surprising once you take into account that each stage of the processing, the image quality was reduced more and more. However, it was 1959 and it was the first time it had been done, and they were still good enough to show that the far side of the Moon was very different to the Earth-facing side. The very first image of Earth from farther away than low Earth orbit was by Explorer 6, and also in 1959 from 27,000 kilometres, and was part of a test of an all-electronic scanning system to measure cloud cover. This image is of the sunlit clouds above the central Pacific, though it's hardly what you could call good. Compare that to the blue marble shot of the entire Earth by the crew of Apollo 17 in 1972, whilst on its way to the Moon and using a 70mm Hasselblad with an 80mm lens. Things obviously had to change a lot if we were to send space probes tens or hundreds of millions of kilometres to the planet and see something better than the best telescopes on Earth. In 1964, Mariner 4 became the first spacecraft to do a flyby of Mars and take close-up images. Unlike Luna 3, Mariner 4 used a slow-scan Vidicon TV tube to gather the images of the Martian surface. The analog signal output of the tube was then converted to a digital format and then stored on a magnetic tape recorder, the predecessor to today's hard drives. After the camera finished taking the pictures, they were replayed back from the tape and sent back to Earth for processing at JPL. Because it was going to take the computer a long time to create the images, we are talking of a 1964 mainframe here, and the need to get something out quickly to the press, when the first image data was received, one of the team at NASA used crayons from a local art store to colour strips of data that they saw on the monitor screen, a bit like painting by numbers, and this became the very first image of another planet. When the actual monochrome version was assembled and printed out by the computer, it was surprising how well the hand-drawn version looked in comparison, and that is now on display at the JPL labs at Pasadena, California. In 1975, the Soviets became the first to successfully take pictures from the surface of another planet. This time, it was Venus. They knew the US was planning the Viking Mars lander, but due to budget restraints and issues with long-term reliability of their navigation, they chose Venus as a closer target. But a Venus landing makes a Mars landing look like a walk in the park. When it landed, it recorded an atmospheric pressure 90 times that of Earth, and the temperature was 485 degrees Celsius. Although the surface of Venus is completely obscured by thick clouds from above, from below, the pictures it sent back of the surface show that it was about the same brightness as an overcast summer's day here on Earth, and with good visibility and little atmospheric dust, with rocks scattered around the lander. To get the images back to Earth, the lander relayed the pictures back to Earth via the orbiter, which had also carried the lander, and this was also the first craft to orbit Venus. The lander had two 180-degree cameras, which would have given a full 360-degree view, but the lens cover of one failed to detach on landing. The cameras themselves were photographic scanning devices with moving mirrors. The resolution of each was about 70,000 pixels made up of a 500 by 128 pixel frame. Although it was thought that the heat and pressure destroyed the lander after 53 minutes on the surface, a Soviet source later said that the transmission had stopped because the orbiter had moved out of the communication range of the lander. Taking pictures of a planet hundreds of millions or billions of kilometers away poses many problems. Firstly, there is just the lack of light. The amount of sunlight compared to here on Earth is about 1,000 times less when you get out to the distance of Pluto. High noon on Pluto is the equivalent of what NASA calls Pluto time on Earth. That's around dusk and dawn, and roughly when you would have to turn on the headlights of your car. Taking images of asteroids is even harder and akin to photographing a piece of coal in moonlight whilst travelling faster than a bullet. This means that the camera exposures must be much longer to gather enough light, but then the speed of the spacecraft, New Horizons for example, is travelling at 16.2 kilometers per second, almost 60,000 kilometers per hour, and would introduce motion blur if the cameras don't exactly track the object they are flying by. And it's not as if you can just press a button here on Earth and they will take a picture on the spacecraft. The distances are so great that it takes 4.5 hours to send a radio signal to Pluto at the speed of light. So everything has to be pre-programmed and timed to the second in order to turn the camera or the spacecraft at the correct speed and at the correct time to get the exposure without motion blur or missing the object completely. And all that is done by the spacecraft by itself. Only hours or days after will the team on Earth know if it's worked correctly. Then there is the radiation. Not only the cosmic rays from deep space, but around the planets themselves. Just like the Earth's magnetic field captures and concentrates charged particles from the Sun in the Van Allen belt, Jupiter and Saturn do the same, only on a much larger scale. Due to the interaction of Jupiter's rings, yes, it has rings like Saturn, but just much smaller, and the volcanic emissions from Jupiter's moon Io, there are areas of intense radiation around Jupiter, some 10,000 times that of the Van Allen belts around Earth. So the cameras and electronics on spacecraft like the Juno Jupiter orbiter, which launched in 2011 and will fly closer to Jupiter than any other craft, are especially radiation hardened. The CPU on Juno is rated to withstand 1 million rads and 20 million rads over its lifetime. If a human were exposed to 1,000 rads for a few hours, the result would almost invariably be fatal. The CPU and other electronics are encased in a radiation vault, which has up to 25 millimeter thick titanium walls, which reduces the radiation by a factor of 800. The camera itself uses a codec KAI 2020 sensor with a resolution of 1600 by 1200 pixels, with modifications and a special housing to mitigate the intense radiation. The power supply, the length of time that it has to operate, also limit the size of the cameras and the strength of the transmissions back to Earth. Nuclear-powered radioisotope thermoelectric generators are used and can last for decades, but their output is low at just a few hundred watts. The Voyagers used two cameras, which were modified versions of the slow-scan Vidicon tubes used on the earlier Mariner missions. One has a low-resolution 200mm wide-angle lens and an aperture of f3, whilst the other uses a higher-resolution 1500mm narrow-angle f8.5 lens. The resolution of the images, after they'd been digitised, was just 800 by 800 pixels. Although we see colour images taken by the Voyager probes, they actually only sent black and white ones. Each camera has 8 coloured filters in a controllable wheel that rotates in front of the camera. So for a colour image, they would take 3 monochrome images, one each through a different filter, usually red, green and blue. These 3 images would then be combined to make the full colour image when they're received back on Earth. Using this method, they can get a higher resolution than if the camera used a colour camera tube. Often they might need to take images as part of a spectrum which we can't see, like infrared or ultraviolet, so a monochrome camera and filter combination works much better. The cameras on Voyager could take up to 1,800 images per day, far quicker than could be sent back to Earth. These were stored on magnetic tape, like on the Mariner probes. The digital data would then be replayed back and sent to Earth at a speed of around 7.2 kilobits per second, which was at the distance of around about Jupiter. With an individual picture taking up about 5.2 megabytes of data and allowing only for a basic compression method available at the time and error correction, which sent extra data in case some of the signal was lost, it would take about 4 to 5 minutes to send each image. So for a full day's worth of 1,800 images, it would take just over 6 days to send them back to Earth. By the time the Voyagers were at the distance of the outer planets, the bandwidth had dropped to around 160 bits per second. At this speed, it now takes 9 hours to send one image, and 1,800 images would take 1.8 years. Even on modern spacecraft, the data rates are very slow compared to what we're used to. New Horizons' data rate from Pluto in 2015 was just 2 kilobits per second, not 2 kilobytes, 2 kilobits. And it's even farther away now. This is why it will take up to a year to send back all the images of Ultima Thule taken in December 2018. Something that a lot of people don't realise is that the pictures we see are mostly for public consumption and PR, but they're not that important from a purely scientific point of view. Most of the real science is done by the other instruments which are carried on board. JunoCam was put on the Juno-Jupiter orbiter primarily for public science, greater public engagement, and to make all the images available on NASA's website. Its low resolution and fixed mounting to the spacecraft body led to it being referred to by some as Juno's dash cam. It was designed to survive 8 orbits around Jupiter, but as of 2018, it had survived 17, so it's now been tasked with more scientific duties as well. If you were wondering why these billion-dollar spacecraft don't use the latest multi-megapixel camera sensors, it's because they need reliability above everything else. So they use tried and trusted technology, which at the time of the design is often a decade or more old. It then takes years to build and then launch, again working with the original trusted design where possible. When New Horizons was launched in 2006, it was already nearly a 15-year-old design and it wouldn't arrive at Pluto for another 9 years. Using this method of tried and trusted technology has proven itself many times now, with the best known examples of Voyagers 1 and 2 working for the best part of 50 years, and maybe more if their nuclear power supplies can hang on in there a little longer. All of the missions we have launched to photograph and find out more about our solar system have had unforeseen issues, which have had to be fixed, with the craft hurtling through space millions or billions of kilometres from Earth. Problems that tax their creators and operators every bit as much as they did their original design all those years ago. If you like to challenge yourself, then our sponsor for this video, Brilliant.org, has something that will be right up your street. Brilliant's daily problems provide you with a challenge and a context and framework that you need to work them out, so you learn the concepts by applying them. If you like the daily problem, then there are more like it, so you can explore the concept in greater detail and develop your framework. If you are confused and need more guidance, then you can join the community in discussing these problems. These thought-provoking challenges will lead you from curiosity to mastery one day at a time. So, what are you waiting for? Go to brilliant.org/curiousdroid and finish your day a little smarter, and the first 200 of you to do so will get 20% off of the annual subscription and to view all the problems in the archives.